In the 1970s, Taiwan was falling behind. Taiwan had relied on cheap, labor-intensive manufacturing, things like umbrellas, textiles, and basic electronics assembly. It provided jobs, but it didn't create wealth. The Taiwanese government understood that low-cost manufacturing would never make Taiwan rich fast enough, so it pivoted from labor toward high-end manufacturing, chips. If it could produce them, it would leapfrog into an advanced industrial economy. That bet led to the creation of TSMC. Taiwan Semiconductor Manufacturing Company makes the most advanced chips for Apple, Tesla, NVIDIA, AMD, Amazon. You can't understand TSMC without understanding the man who built it, Morris Chang. He spent decades inside the American semiconductor industry and helped build Texas Instruments into a powerhouse. He believed at one point that he would become its CEO. That never happened. But that disappointment defined his career because leaving Texas Instruments forced him to build something of his own that would come to change the world. To understand how he was chosen to lead the most important company on Earth, we have to go back to the beginning. Morris Chang was born in 1931 when China was on the brink of catastrophe. Imperial Japan was invading, and civil war was tearing China apart from the inside. War would shape the way he understood survival and competition. By the time he turned 18, Chang had changed schools 10 times. At one point, his father worked as a bank manager in Guangzhou, but when Japan began bombing the city, the family fled to British Hong Kong, a rare pocket of calm and order, that is, until Japan attacked Hong Kong and nowhere was safe. In 1942, his family decided to escape across the front lines to reach unoccupied China, a journey lasting more than 50 days, with Japanese shelling a constant fear, which Chang would later call the most significant experience of his life. Eventually, they reached Chongqing, the wartime capital of Free China. He attended an elite boarding school, Nankai Secondary School, despite not having any political or family connections. He was admitted on merit alone. He dreamed of becoming an author, but his father shut that down immediately, telling him, as Chang recalled in his autobiography, "You'll go hungry." His father believed engineering was the future. When Japan surrendered in 1945, Chongqing erupted in celebration, but the peace didn't last. There was continued internal conflict, a brutal civil war between the communists and the nationalist government, the Kuomintang. It was clear Chang had no future in China. And once again, the family fled to Hong Kong. It was there that Chang began looking toward a future abroad. An uncle who was a professor at a university in Boston urged him to apply to Harvard. He was accepted, and in 1948, he boarded a plane for the long journey to the United States. He wrote in his diary, "I have never been so far from home, nor ever planned to be away so long. The future is shrouded in uncertainty. How can I not feel sorrow?" In America, Chang was struck by something new: freedom, democracy, the belief that effort could actually change your fate. In his words, "As long as you work hard, you can succeed." He thrived at Harvard, doing especially well in physics and mathematics. He also excelled in English, despite struggling with Homer at first, and eventually began thinking in his new language. In 1949, the People's Republic of China was founded. The communists now ruled the mainland. Returning home was no longer realistic. For a Chinese immigrant like himself, engineering became his practical path forward. So he transferred to MIT to specialize in mechanical engineering. His parents could only afford 1 year of tuition, so he supported himself with a scholarship, doing calculation work for professors, and typing jobs to make ends meet. Though his father earned an MBA from Columbia at 47, he didn't become successful and scraped by running a small shop. All of his parents' unfulfilled hopes were pinned on their only child. After completing a bachelor's degree, getting married, and finishing his master's, he set his sights on what many Chinese immigrants saw as the path toward a secure future, a doctorate. But the qualifying exam broke him. When he failed the first time, he was still confident he could pass, but he failed on his second try as well. He recalled, "This was the greatest blow of my life. My self-confidence evaporated in an instant." But what seemed like a crushing disappointment at the time came to be the greatest blessing of his life. Had he succeeded, he would have been locked into academia, and he would have never touched semiconductors. He looked back on his failure with a different perspective, calling it the greatest stroke of luck in my life. Instead of a doctorate, he entered the workforce. Within 2 months, he had 4 job offers. The first was from a machine tool manufacturer, but the salary was too low. The second came from the industrial firm Metals and Controls, but he found the president authoritarian. The third was a research and development role with the Ford Motor Company. And then there was a fourth. An electronics company called Sylvania had just created a new laboratory dedicated to something Chang had never heard of, transistors. A transistor is the basic building block of every microchip. It's a microscopic, electrically controlled switch that turns a current on or off. Each transistor is 10,000 to 20,000 times thinner than a strand of human hair. Billions of them fit onto a single computer chip. These are among the most difficult things human beings have ever manufactured. The world is built by people who understand how things work deeply. If you'd like to sharpen your math, science, and computer science skills to solve harder problems at work or in life, Brilliant is a great place to start, and you can try it for free. Brilliant is a website and app that helps you intuitively understand how things work through hands-on problem solving, not memorization. If you want to understand how computer chips actually work, their circuits course helps you build intuition for how electrical systems behave. And digital circuits shows how logic gates combine to form simple computers. I also really like their algorithmic thinking course, which teaches you how complex problems are broken down and solved by computers. If your goal is to build healthy habits and keep improving, especially as we head into the new year, it's a great time to start learning with Brilliant. You can try Brilliant for free for 30 days at brilliant.org/newsthink. The link is in the description, or by scanning the QR code on your screen. And if you decide to continue, you'll also get 20% off an annual premium subscription with unlimited access to everything on Brilliant. Even a single speck of dust landing on a transistor can destroy an entire chip. That's why semiconductor factories, or fabs, short for fabrication plants, look more like clean rooms, with workers covered head to toe, protecting the chip from the world. Chang initially leaned toward choosing Ford. It was stable, prestigious, safe, but Ford offered him $1 less per month than Sylvania, $479 instead of $480. When he called to try to negotiate, Ford's recruiter shut him down. "We do not haggle. The company has decided on your salary. If you want to join, come. If not, then farewell." Chang really didn't like that response and chose Sylvania. A life-altering decision over $1. Chang began teaching himself everything about semiconductors. Every night, he worked through William Shockley's Electrons and Holes in Semiconductors, a book he found brutally difficult. He read just 2 pages a night. He wanted to understand everything completely. No shortcuts. Semiconductors demanded the same mindset, not speed, but discipline. At Sylvania, Chang worked on germanium transistors, an easier material to process than silicon, but fundamentally inferior. Almost the entire industry used germanium, except for a small company in Dallas. Texas Instruments was already mass-producing silicon transistors, a far more powerful material that most companies believed was too difficult to manufacture. Chang eventually rose to head a research and development group at Sylvania, but he could already see the company was falling behind and never forgot the words of the general manager of the semiconductor division.
He said, our trouble at Sylvania is that we cannot make what we can sell and we cannot sell what we can make. Now, ever since then, I've tried to stay away from that.
When an opportunity appeared at Texas Instruments, Chang didn't hesitate. He joined TI in 1958 and was impressed by the young, ambitious, and intensely driven engineers, most of whom were under 40. Chang was quickly entrusted with tackling one of the hardest problems, improving the quality of transistors. His job was to increase yield, the single most important metric in chip making. Yield measures how many usable chips survive the manufacturing process. Improve yield, and costs fall. Chang succeeded and built a reputation as someone who deeply understood manufacturing. When it became clear that a PhD was next rung up the ladder, Texas Instruments sent him to Stanford. When he returned to the company 3 years later, he was promoted again and his career rose steadily. But by the late 1970s, something had changed. Texas Instruments was shifting its focus toward calculators, digital watches, and consumer electronics. Chang's passion had always been semiconductors, so the road ahead was narrowing. After 25 years at the company, Chang realized there was no realistic path to him becoming CEO, so he quit with no job lined up. He was 52 years old. He worked briefly as the COO of the electronics manufacturer General Instrument in New York and lived in Trump Tower. But the work didn't appeal to him, as General Instrument mainly helped acquire and merge companies. What did matter during this period was someone he met, an entrepreneur with a radical idea. The entrepreneur later started a company that would design chips but not manufacture them. This was unheard of at the time. Chip companies were expected to do both, design the chip and build it. But Chang understood that design and manufacturing were becoming two completely different problems, and manufacturing was getting impossibly expensive. Most companies wouldn't be able to afford the factories to build them. It was a realization that would soon change the course of the world. Chang was regarded as a world-class chip expert by then, and caught the attention of Taiwan, which was trying to leap from low-cost manufacturing into a high-tech economy. In 1973, the Taiwanese government established a research institute, ITRI, to learn advanced manufacturing and build a domestic semiconductor industry. Chang became the head of the institute in 1985. Moving to Asia appealed to him. Years earlier, at Texas Instruments, Chang had seen the potential taking shape in the region. TI's factory in Japan was achieving nearly double the production yield of its factory in Texas. When he was sent to Japan to find out why, he discovered turnover was dramatically lower and technicians were better qualified than in the US, where he found out that the top candidate for a supervisor role at an American plant had a degree in French literature and no engineering background. Chang realized that the future of advanced manufacturing wasn't in the United States, it was in Asia. He proposed a radical idea, a factory that wouldn't design its own chips at all, but just build chips for others, focusing purely on manufacturing. Li Guoding, the economist and politician known as the godfather of Taiwan's tech industry, asked Chang to make the idea commercially viable. In 1987, Morris Chang founded TSMC. He wanted to take on the giants, Intel and Samsung, companies that still designed and manufactured chips under one roof. That competitive streak was shaped growing up in wartime.
I often compare the competitive battles that TSMC goes through with competitors with the battles in the Second World War.
TSMC actually secured Intel as its first major American customer. And years later, another important client arrived. Jensen Huang had co-founded a small company called NVIDIA at the age of 30, but he couldn't get through to Chang on the phone at first. Desperate, he sent a letter asking whether TSMC would make his chips. Chang decided to call him. He liked the young man and agreed. NVIDIA's first two successful chips, RIVA 128 and RIVA TNT, were made by TSMC. With TSMC's manufacturing, NVIDIA has emerged as the leading designer of chips for artificial intelligence. What began as a business relationship became something closer to a mentorship. In Morris Chang's Taipei office hangs a framed comic given to him by Jensen with an inscription that reads, "Your career is a masterpiece, a Beethoven's Ninth Symphony. Working with you has been one of the great joys of my career." In 1995, TSMC passed a major milestone, surpassing $1 billion in annual revenue. TSMC now produces over 90% of the world's most advanced chips. Chang served as CEO from its founding in 1987 through 2005, but when the next CEO struggled to lead, Chang returned as CEO in 2009 at age 78 to study the ship. He finally retired for good in 2018. Today, TSMC's market cap hovers around the $1 trillion level, placing it among the world's most valuable companies and arguably the most important. From Apple's M-series chips to Tesla's full self-driving chips, TSMC manufactures the chips that power modern life. Governments now treat semiconductor manufacturing as a matter of national security. The United States has been pouring billions into domestic chip making, with TSMC building multiple factories in Arizona.
This is a tremendous move by the most powerful company in the world.
Yet, despite expanding beyond Taiwan, TSMC's most advanced chips are still manufactured in Taiwan itself, though the US fabs plan to catch up. Morris Chang didn't just build a company. He built a platform, one the world simply can't do without. Thanks for watching. For NewsThink, I'm Cindy Palm.